Hi, everyone. Those of you who attend Sunday school here at St. James Episcopal Church in Warrenton, Virginia, know that I am Miss Norma. Today we're celebrating Palm Sunday, which reminds us of the day that Jesus entered Jerusalem on the first day of the last week of his life here on earth. The lesson takes us through Palm Sunday through Good Friday. Even if you've heard this story before, I ask you to listen with new ears because it's likely been a whole year since you've heard the story. And you've grown, you've changed, and maybe you've never heard this story before at all. I wanted to tell you that the pictures I use to tell this story are by different artists. So Jesus may look different in various pictures. And sometimes when Jesus is carrying the cross, he'll be carrying the whole cross, and sometimes he'll carry just the cross beam, which is really more likely. The Bible doesn't tell us very much about Jesus growing up. We know, of course, that he was born in a manger or in a barn, and he had Mother Mary and Father Joseph who loved the baby and took care of him. Then the Bible skips to where Jesus is about 12, and he and his family travel to Jerusalem, the large city where the temple was, to celebrate Passover. Now, Passover was a very special Jewish holiday that commemorated the freeing of God's people from slavery in Egypt. So it's a very special day. So they had gone there with other members of their family and friends and neighbors from the town of Nazareth to Jerusalem to worship at the temple in Jerusalem. On the way back home, Mary and Joseph suddenly discovered that Jesus wasn't with them. So they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. They looked everywhere. They looked where they had eaten and where they had stayed and in the alleyways. And finally they found Jesus in the temple. And Jesus was teaching the rabbis, and the rabbis were teaching Jesus. And Jesus said to his parents, "Didn't you know I would be in my Father's house?" Then when Jesus was about 30, he was baptized by his cousin, John the Baptist. Jesus went to John and asked him to baptize him, and John said, "You are the Messiah, you are the chosen one, you should be baptizing me." But Jesus said, "No, I need you to baptize me." So in the muddy river water, they went down, down, down into the water. And when Jesus came back up, a dove from heaven was above his head, and a voice from heaven, God's voice, said, "You are my son, and I love you very much." Then Jesus began choosing 12 special people who would help him on his mission to establish God's kingdom on earth. That was the passion of Jesus. He loved God, his Father, so much. He wanted to establish his kingdom here on earth. The disciples went everywhere with Jesus as he taught and he performed miracles and gave lessons and spoke in parables and healed people. This picture shows Jesus delivering a long, long sermon. And he was on top of the mountain and people were all around him. And there were about 5,000 people there that day. And about after a while, the disciples said, "Jesus, the people are getting hungry. Should we send them home or go out for food and bring it back?" And Jesus said, "No, bring me what you have here and it will be enough." So the disciples brought him a few fishes and a little bit of bread, and Jesus blessed it. And then there was so much food that it not only fed 5,000 people, but they had leftover food. Nature also listened to Jesus. When storms would come, he would speak and the wind and the waves would calm down. And this is a picture of one time when the disciples were out in the boat and they had fished all night and didn't catch one single fish. And Jesus called to them and said, put your nets on the other side of the boat. And they said, that doesn't make any sense. This is all one sea. The fishes that were on one side will be on the other. But they knew he was their rabbi, their teacher. So they did as he said. And as soon as they put their nets down in the other side of the boat, suddenly the nets were so heavy with fish they could barely lift them. And Jesus loved children. One time when he was teaching, some children came to see Jesus, and the disciples were saying, no, they're too loud, they're too noisy, they're not important. But Jesus said, no, the children are the kingdom of God. Bring them to me. So God always loved children. Jesus gave sight to the blind. He healed people who had been deaf so that they could hear. Those that were crippled and couldn't walk, he made them be able to hop, skip, and jump as they chose. There were even three people who had died that Jesus brought back to life. And this is one of them. After 3 years of teaching and healing and talking to the people and being with them, Jesus knew that his time on earth was coming to an end. And this is the center of our faith, that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, not just back in Bible times or before, but now, even now and in the future. Jesus loved us so much that he died for our sins. One of the best known Bible verses is John 3:16. And it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that we may not perish but have everlasting life. The Bible tells us that Jesus turned his face toward Jerusalem. He knew it was time for him to go there. Now, Jerusalem was a large city. It had probably about 40,000 people back in Jesus' time. And it was under the rule of the Roman Empire. So nearly everybody who lived in Jerusalem was Jewish, but they were governed by the Roman people. And the Romans sent a governor to live in the palace there. Well, the governor wanted some help, so he chose the leaders of the Jewish religion to be his helpers to manage the Jewish people. And the Jewish leaders were called the chief priests, the elders, who were probably very wealthy men, and the scribes, who were record keepers and experts on the law. It was hard times for the Jewish people. They were dominated by the Jewish leaders and the Roman Empire. They were bossed around, they were told what to do, how much taxes they had to pay, very high taxes. They had to follow very strict rules and laws. And they said to one another, it's almost like our ancestors were slaves back in Egypt. That's how we feel. We don't really have any freedom. They wanted someone to come and save them, to overthrow the Roman government. But Jesus was not that kind of king. He was the king of the Jews, but not what they were expecting. Jesus' disciples and Jesus entered Jerusalem on a Sunday. And instead of coming on a big white horse with ribbons in its hair, he chose to come in riding on a simple donkey. The people who had been following Jesus around and listening to him teach followed him into Jerusalem, and they waved palm branches. This is a palm right here. And waving a palm was a sign of honor. So people had big palms that they waved around Jesus, and they yelled out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. They were so excited. Their king was finally coming to Jerusalem. The next day, Monday, Jesus went to the temple. people were there buying birds and animals, and there were people there that were called money changers. And it's a little bit hard to understand, so let me explain it in today's terms. So if you and I went to Mexico, we would need to exchange our American dollars for pesos, the money used in Mexico. Or if we went to Europe, we would need to exchange our American dollars for euros. So we would need to convert our money to the type of money used wherever we were. So remember I told you there were about 200,000 visitors coming to Jerusalem for the Passover. So they came from all different areas, and they each had their own kind of money that they used at home. So they had to go to the money changers to change their money into the money used in Jerusalem, so then that they could buy the birds and animals that would be used for sacrifices. Giving a live sacrifice was how people back in Bible times believed that they could be forgiven from their sins. So I used to think that when Jesus went to the temple and saw this, that's what he was mad about, that they were doing business in his Father's house. But I studied some more and I found out that that was really a custom that was to be expected. They had to do that. What Jesus was so angry about when he got to the temple was he realized that the religious leaders and the Roman government had been using the temple as part of the way to control the people. And Jesus said, "Did you not know that my Father's house is a house of prayer for all nations?" And he drove out the people that were selling birds and animals, and he overturned the tables of the people that were exchanging the outside money for the Jerusalem money. So Jesus was angry. And guess what? When he did that, he made the religious leaders angrier about him. They said, Who is this person that's coming in here and taking over? He's going to take our power. The people are going to start following him instead of listening to us. He is upsetting what we have in place. We've got to get rid of this man, Jesus. So Jesus symbolically closed down the temple. The leaders felt that Jesus was taking their power and giving it to God, because Jesus kept talking about building the kingdom of God on earth. On Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday of that week, Jesus went back to the temple and taught the people good lessons. And the leaders questioned him. They said, "Who are you? Who gave you the right to come in here to this temple and preach?" And they asked him questions to try to trick Jesus. But Jesus would not be fooled. In fact, he told some stories, parables, that made the leaders look foolish. They were even more determined to get rid of Jesus, this troublemaker. But the people loved Jesus so much that the leaders knew that they would have to get Jesus at a time when nobody else was around. And one of Jesus' disciples chose to betray him. His name was Judas. Now, the Bible doesn't give any reasons why Judas decided to betray Jesus. Bible scholars have many opinions. Well, maybe Judas was one of those people who thought that Jesus was going to come and overthrow the Roman government and be an earthly leader. But he knew that wasn't to be so. Maybe he was disappointed in Jesus. We don't know. But Judas went to the religious leaders and told them he would betray Jesus, and they gave him 30 pieces of silver in payment. On Thursday, Jesus knew that that would be the last day he would have a full day alive with his disciples. So he sent two of them to secretly get a room, rent a room, and prepare a Passover meal, so that he could have a last meal with his disciples. You know, back in Bible times, people wore sandals and the roads were so dusty, so that when people came to their homes, there was usually someone there with a cloth and a basin of water, sometimes a servant, sometimes not, who would wash everybody's feet so that they didn't drag in that dust from the outside into their homes. So when Jesus and the disciples went to the upper room to have their last meal together, there was no one there to clean their feet because they were meeting in secret. And what Jesus did was he took off his outer cloak and he knelt down with a basin of water and a towel and he began to wash his disciples' feet. The disciples were upset. They said, "You are our Messiah, you are our teacher, our rabbi. You're not the servant. We should be washing your feet." And Jesus said, "No, I'm setting an example for you. I want you to go out in the world and do as I have done to build God's kingdom here on earth, to show God's love." Jesus didn't mean that they should go out and wash everybody's feet that they came in contact with, but no, to spread God's love, to live as Jesus had lived, to live as the example. So as Jesus sat at the last meal with his 12 disciples, he said to them, "One of you will betray me." And the disciples were upset, except for Judas, because he knew it was him. And they all said, "Is it me? Is it I? Am I the one that's going to betray you, Jesus?" But Jesus didn't answer. And Jesus took the bread, and he broke it, and blessed it, and gave it to them. And he said, "This is my body, which will be broken for you." And then Jesus took the cup of wine, and he blessed it, and he gave it to them. They passed the cup around, and he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, which will be shed for you. Do this and remember me." So every Sunday when we have Holy Eucharist here at St. James Church, we remember the Last Supper and we celebrate what Jesus did for us. And after the meal, Judas left. Jesus and the other 11 disciples went to the Garden of Gethsemane because Jesus wanted to pray. He told the disciples, "You stay here at the front and keep watch. I need to talk to my Father in prayer." It was very late, and the disciples fell asleep. One prayer that Jesus prayed to God his Father was, "Father, if it's possible for me not to have to go through this, then let it be. Let me not have to suffer. But if I will do your will, if this is what needs to happen, then I will do it." Jesus prayed earnestly to God his Father, and Jesus was obedient to God. He said, "Thy will be done." Now, remember that Jesus was a real man when he lived here on earth. And he knew what was going to happen, so the Bible tells us that Jesus was distressed and agitated and deeply aggrieved. But still he said, "Thy will be done." When Jesus was done praying, he went back and found the disciples asleep. And he said, "Could you not even keep watch for a while? But never mind. It's time for you to get up. See, my betrayer is at hand." And here comes Judas with a band of army people from the temple authorities. And Judas went up to Jesus and kissed him on the cheek and said, "Rabbi, teacher," because that was the sign that Judas had arranged with the soldiers to identify Jesus. The soldiers bound Jesus' hands behind him, and they took him to a secret trial with the high priest, the chief priest, the elders, and the scribes. It was a secret trial. It was unfair. It was during the night. There are no trials at night. You might be able to see in the window the dark sky and the stars shining through. And they questioned Jesus, and they hit him. And finally they said, "This man says he's the Son of God. That in and of itself is enough to send him to death." But the Jewish leaders could not put Jesus to death by themselves. So around daybreak, just as the sun was coming up, they took Jesus to the palace, to the Roman governor, Pilate. And they explained what had happened and that they wanted to put him to death. Pilate questioned him. He said, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "You say it is so." Pilate asked the other questions, but Jesus wouldn't answer anything else. Pilate knew the leaders were very jealous of Jesus. He didn't really see anything that Jesus had done wrong, so he thought, well, maybe if I just have this man beaten, they will be satisfied. So Pilate gave the order to have Jesus beaten. But the soldiers took it too far. They beat Jesus almost to death. They took his clothes and put on him a purple robe because purple was a sign of royalty. They were making fun of Jesus. And then they took a crown of thorns. A crown of thorns and smashed it down on Jesus' head. Because every king needs a crown, right? And they pretended to worship him. They said, "Hail, Jesus, King of the Jews." And they spit on him and hit him more. Then they led him back to Pilate. And Pilate said to the crowd of people who were not the people that loved Jesus that had been following him, but they were the crowd of people that the Jewish leaders had gotten, religious leaders had gotten together. And they stirred them up and they said, hate this man, he's trying to take our power. And so when Pilate asked the crowd, "What would you like me to do with this man?" And they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Nail him to a cross." So Pilate gave the order for Jesus to be crucified. Now, when people were crucified back in Bible times by the Roman government, part of that was to teach people a lesson. The only people that got crucified were those that were against the government that tried to take over. And when people would be hung on the cross, then their bodies would often be left for several days as they lay there on the cross, dead, as a silent warning message to other people. See what happened to this guy? You better behave, you better listen to what we're saying, or this could be you. So then, probably around 8 o'clock, the soldiers affixed the crossbeam to Jesus' arms. It was morning now, and the other people were awake, the people that had loved Jesus and followed him, and even his mother and the other women that had taken care of him were there now, and they were weeping and wailing because they knew what was about to happen. And remember that Jesus' body was very weak from the beating. As he walked carrying that crossbeam on his arms, he was so weak that he often fell. He fell, and this is one of my favorite pictures. Not because it represents anything happy or joyous, but because it shows Jesus beaten down, but still carrying that cross, holding that cross on his shoulders, like he carries our sins. Jesus was so weak, soldiers pulled another person from the crowd, Simon of Cyrene, to help Jesus carry the cross to Golgotha. And Then about 9 in the morning, they reached the site. And they nailed Jesus' arms to that crossbeam. And then they lifted it and Jesus up to the vertical beam that was in the ground. And they placed a plaque above Jesus' head that mocked Jesus. It said, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." But the religious leaders were upset to see that sign. They said, "No, he's not our king." But Pilate left it in place. Jesus hung on the cross from 9 a.m. And then at noon, a darkness came over all the land. And there's Jesus hanging beside two other people that were killed that day. With the darkness over the whole land, then at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus cried out, took his last breath, and died. Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate and asked him if he could take Jesus' body down from the cross and place it in a tomb. Not sure why Pilate gave the approval, since most of the time the bodies were left on the cross for several days. Maybe because it was Passover and Pilate knew that there were a lot of visitors there and didn't want them to see it. We don't know. But at any rate, Pilate gave Joseph of Arimathea permission to take Jesus' body down. And so they lowered it down into the arms of Mary, his mother. And I'll share something personal with you. Each Sunday when I have my arms outstretched to receive the piece of bread, the wafer that represents Jesus' body, I think about Jesus' head being lowered into Mary's hands, and that's what I think about. So it makes it more real for me thinking about that, because she probably cradled Jesus' head here just like she did when she cradled it when he was a baby and a young boy. So around 6 p.m. is when that happened. Sunset would mark the end of the would mark the beginning of the Jewish day, the Sabbath. So they took the body down, and Joseph of Arimathea wrapped it in linen, and they took him to a hillside tomb, and he laid him on the table, stone table, and then would roll the stone across the entrance. Would look something like this. Here's the tomb. Here's Jesus' body. Here's the big stone that was rolled across the entrance. And that's where our story ends for the day, with Jesus dead and alone and sealed inside the tomb. I'm going to ask you some wondering questions, because when we learn something new, when we hear a story, we'll remember it so much better if we think about it and ask ourselves questions about it and try to figure out, what does this mean to me? So while I read the questions, you're going to be looking at a stained glass window here at St. James. You can either answer these questions out loud, or you can think about them in your own heart or your own mind. And if you're watching this with other people, maybe you're going to talk with them about it, about how they feel. I wonder how Mary felt watching her son go through this terrible suffering. I wonder if the disciples were afraid soldiers would come and arrest them too. I wonder if you and I would have been brave enough to stand at the cross and pray for Jesus. I wonder how Jesus could possibly love us enough to die for us like that. I wonder if we each can be the person that Jesus wants us to be. And I wonder what part of the story you liked best. You know, I like stones. I collect them. Sometimes people bring me stones as a gift. And stones are very important to this lesson that we heard today because it represents great sadness when we think about Jesus being sealed by the stone, left alone dead in the tomb. That's very sad. And next Sunday, on Easter Sunday, we learn that the stone represents great joy because when the women went to the tomb to prepare Jesus' body more for death, that stone was rolled away and the tomb was empty. I hope you have been blessed by listening to this story. And I want you to remember that God still and always so loves this world, and that includes you.